Greetings from eMedi News and Heartcare Foundation of India. Welcome to the show, Chat with Dr. KK. And today we have with us Dr. Rajiv Bajaj, a senior cardiologist with Batra Hospital and Medical Research Center. Welcome to our show.
Hello.
Recently, Cardiological Society of India has come out with guidelines on prosthetic valve. It's congratulations to CSI and to you for coordinating the whole thing. And I think for the first time, CSI, this is the first guideline, the Indian guidelines, as far as cardiology is concerned. Now, I would like to ask you a simple question, that for a patient, for a GP, for an MD physician, and for a DM, what these guidelines have to say, starting, say for a GP, what a family physician should know about these guidelines?
See, doctors already know that when a patient receives a prosthetic valve, it is not the end of his medical treatment. The prosthetic valve itself being made of metal or sometimes made of biomaterials, it requires continuous care. In any case, many of the cardiac operations are palliative rather than curative. So the heart disease has not completely been removed, it has been improved. With prosthetic valves, the big problem has been that the patient has to take blood thinners. And these are not the ordinary blood thinners like aspirin, which we give to many patients with heart attack, etc. These are very strong and much more complex medications which require blood testing on a regular basis. The INR test for Coumadin group of anticoagulants. The Indian experience has been somewhat dismal till now. And the problems have been that patients come from faraway places and are not sometimes educated. They do not understand the importance of regular blood tests. The medication itself they may not be able to procure if there are any cost issues or if they are from a remote place. The test itself is extremely difficult to do. Although many small labs are able to do the test, the truth is that unless you are able to do it accurately and reliably, the report that you get will not be sufficient to manage the case properly. Since the medicine is a blood thinner, if the dose becomes excessive, bleeding is very common, and fatal bleeding into the brain and all is a known problem. If the medicine is a bit less than what the patient needed, then also there is a problem that the valve may clot or it may throw small clots into the brain and other parts of the body, creating medical emergencies. So the care of a patient with prosthetic valve requires meticulous care and accurate blood reports. INR testing requires very reliable reagents which are not yet manufactured in India.
These are the points. What are the, if I have to summarize the guidelines into 5 points, what does the guidelines say?
That the patient has to be told where the reliable test can be made available from.
So that means if you're putting in a prosthetic valve,
the facility for an
INR should be available in that city. And if it is not available, what would you do?
If it is not available, you may even take the option that some of the government hospitals are offering their patients, that you have a bioprosthesis. That is a temporary solution because it may not last more than 10 or 12 years. But at least those do not require blood testing lifelong. And once the initial treatment...
So the first guideline is if facility for INR is not available,
then metallic should not be put. Prosthesis cannot be put.
That's one.
That is one.
Okay. Second guideline?
Second has been that since the disease is not completely cured, we need to give them other cardiac medications also. There is a lot of research on what other medications a heart patient requires so that his heart is able to function and give him a normal lifespan. You see, if he has an operation at the age of 20 and gets a mitral valve, after a few years when he is doing well, it looks like a good operation. But at 40, if he gets heart failure, then it's something which is not going to be easily treatable and he may be dead in 2 or 3 or 4 years at the prime of his life. So those medications also our recommendations have gone into and looked
after. So these patients should not only be on blood thinner, they should also be on other
medications
to prevent heart failure in future.
Future.
Is there any guideline for infection control, for infective endocarditis?
Yes, we have included recommendations on infective endocarditis. We have included recommendations on how the patient will be treated if he gets hepatitis. because that interferes with blood thinners and the dose has to be adjusted immediately. We have given special instructions for the first year because most of the problems occur in the first year. So the first 12 months we consider critical, and that is the experience all over the world. And we made special rules on how these patients will be tided over during this very difficult
period.
Are
there any guidelines which talks about that these patients has to be managed and followed up only by the person, surgeons, or
no.
by, it can be done by the GPs?
Well, we have given all the tests that the patient will have, and if the facilities are available, then it can be done in a district level hospital or by an MD or even by an MBBS in a remote location, provided he has all the facilities. If he doesn't have 2-yearly echo available, then that he will have to send to some other center. But those that he can do...
Your recommendation is echo every 2 years.
At present, we are recommending SOS and every 2 years, at 3 months after surgery and at 1 year after surgery.
3 months after surgery, 1 year after surgery. Any recommendation for pregnancy?
Yes. There's a very large section not only on pregnancy, but also intercurrent surgeries that a person may require, hernia, etc. The blood thinners have to be looked after at that time. And we have given all the protocols on how to get these patients through other operations, through pregnancy, through delivery. We have included a special section on menstruating women, because for them also it becomes a big problem to take blood thinners. Every month they have profuse bleeding and may develop anemia, etc.
So what is the advice?
Well, what we have said is in the first year, we have actually given progesterones to patients who are having very excessive bleeding so that the drugs are not reduced. After the first year is over, if they are not prone to thrombosis, we have allowed that they can stop the blood thinner for 24 hours when the day the menses start and then restart it. And we are recommending that they should take the shorter acting acetcumarol, which is available as Acitrom, rather than the warfarin, which is much longer acting and takes 5 or 6 days for the effect to wear off. So all this is in the recommendation.
So practically these guidelines now are available on the website?
Well, they have published them as a booklet, and they have also said that they are going to disseminate them to physicians through CSIs as well as through API.
I have a very simple question. Will there be a binding?
No.
For a
See,
doctor?
That is a problem for guidelines. Guidelines tend to start dictating terms. They become the standard which everybody has to.
So
and that
the,
is not
in
what we wanted.
Law,
we
in the court of law, guidelines means not obeying guidelines will be taken as negligence.
I hope it will not be, because you see, although I have made every attempt.
It will all depend upon whether you've written may or shall.
We have used language like may and shall.
No, if you've written shall, that becomes a binding. If it is may, it may not.
We have used language that this is what may work better.
May work better, but
see,
not.
See, once we say we that everybody has to do it, then any mistake that I have made, every doctor is forced to make. Although we have tried to include a lot of doctors into the process, we had a series of meetings, we had used the internet extensively to send every draft to every member. We had invited everybody
so
from CSI to join.
So how many members were there in the...
In this committee, there were 15 members.
15 members from trans across the country?
Yes.
Any international expert?
No, we had not taken... international experts, but we have taken experts from outside cardiology, like for the PTINR, we have taken clinical pathologists of very senior stature in India. We have included CTVS surgeons.
Normally, when the government of India comes out with any act, before they release it, they put it on the website and invite suggestions from the members.
The
CSI
has put it as a publication and distributed it to every member in the previous conference.
Okay.
They also had a general body session where everybody was invited.
So although 1 year was given to members. Did you get any objections, any suggestions?
No, I did get a lot of emails on that it is all right. I also got some emails suggesting that some language or wording or some reference which has not been included should be included. But nothing was said in the 1 year which changed the substance of the guidelines.
So it has now become a consistent statement?
Yes. In fact, Dr. Satyavan Sharma, who was involved, has insisted that we should call it a consensus statement rather than guidelines.
Rather than a guideline. But that, as far as the court of law is concerned, even consensus is has a legal
implication. Binding.
It has a legal, it becomes a binding.
See, I have known that
because
in
the Supreme Court judgment is very clear that the prevalent practice cannot be broken.
There is a problem with that, because you see, if you want to impose certain way of functioning on doctors, you can always have an expert committee which you have handpicked, and then you dictate or somehow manage to get the recommendations that you politically want or as a person want. I know this is a big problem with expert committees.
See, in US, I have lots of case examples and case laws where if ACC guidelines were not met, people were penalized.
But I can tell you that I have studied all these ACC guidelines. The truth is, many times they are proving a handicap for the patient's health. This matter can be discussed in any open forum. Everything that is put is not 100% patient-oriented.
Okay, let me go back to the...
Some of it is system-oriented.
Let me go outside the guidelines on the lighter side. What are your hobbies?
I'm a bridge player.
You're a bridge player. That means you're not going to get dementia ever, even if you become 95. For people who play bridge, they never lose their memory.
Dementia is a lifestyle disease, so I look after my lifestyle also.
You look after your lifestyle.
I'm also a very...
Any message as far as lifestyle is concerned? You have lots of your own ideas about lifestyle.
See, I think it's not my ideas. I have been reading research. I was very lucky to...
Okay, out of that goes research. What are four or five things which you follow?
Well, I don't want to upset you, but what I follow is what I have read in the research.
That's what I'm saying.
It says that you should not take too much of sugar.
Okay, so you are basically...
You stop eating...
Or you like to have a low-carb diet?
Yes. Low-carb diet is basically the most important part of lifestyle.
Low-carb diet. You know, in Indian mythology also, very clearly it is written, 80 days in a year, you should not eat carbs.
So if you can do that, then I think you are protecting yourself from most of the problems that the public faces.
Metabolic syndrome, and insulin resistance and others.
And even cancers, gallstones, dental problems, GI problems, dementia. So... The message has to go across.
If any time you end up in opening your own heart hospital, how it will be different from Batra?
Well, I would always expect that any patient who came to me becomes my advertiser. That he is going, insisting to his family, he is insisting to his friends, he is insisting to his people in his office, that unless you have met...
So, it's like customer is a god, so patient is a god.
Yes, you look after him, you make sure that he does well, you make sure that you have done everything very well.
Recently...
And you leave him to spread the word around that unless you have come here and taken my opinion, you are not very sure this is the best opinion, come and take it.
Recently, the recommendations are that for revival of a cardiac arrest, we don't do mouth-to-mouth resuscitation. Simple compression,
yes.
Hands-only CPR is sufficient.
Unless the glottis is obstructed. You see, the air entry is about 300 to 400 cc per each chest compression if the airway is free. So you can't really improve that, because when you stop this thing to give mouth to mouth, that time also you reduce the cardiac output. And if the two people are doing it, then there may be no stopping of the massage, but even then it is not showing any better result.
For a public rescuer CPR, should be hands-on only CPR.
Hands-on CPR. Provided the airway is open. If the airway is obstructed, then something
is... Obviously, there's a drowning, maybe a problem. My last question
sometimes
is,
they vomit and then...
My last question is, if you would not have been a doctor, what you would have been?
I would have been my son. My son is a student of literature.
Literature. So what Dr. Rajiv Bajaj says is that if he would not have been a doctor, he would have been a doctor of literature. He still would have been a doctor, becoming a PhD. Thanks for joining us on the show. And we have learned a lot about prosthetic guidelines. And remember, these guidelines are may and not shall. That means they are suggestive and not meant to increase litigations in the society. That's all for today.
We'll
come
back.
They are to assist and not for making more litigation. That's all for today. We'll come back with one more show. Till that, goodbye. Thank you.
Thank you.